Welcome to the show known as Conversations with Ralph Walker. This is a special edition. Special edition? Yes, we're interviewing candidates that's running for political office, city council, and mayor. Yes, there's an election in April. All right, I'm glad to have you in the studio, Robert. Parry?
Good to see you, Ralph.
All right. Now, to some people, they might say, hey, this is a familiar face, familiar name. And you would say?
I am fairly well known. I ran 2 years ago as the write-in candidate. I'm a fairly well known visitor to.
All right, define that write-in candidate for those viewers out there that may not be familiar with what's a write-in candidate.
Well, two years ago in the council election, there were only two people running for two seats, and I got it in my mind that that wasn't very democratic. So after the filing period, I threw my hat in the ring, and people who chose to write my name on their ballot could cast a vote for me, and about 1,100 people did.
So, 1,100 people?
Yes, 1,084 to be precise.
Are they still in the city of Monrovia?
Well, I didn't exactly get all of their names, although they got mine, so
okay.
We'll see.
All right, so what makes you jump back into the arena?
First off, you know, to go through what I went through as the write-in 2 years ago and not succeed certainly leaves a desire in my mouth to continue serving. I will tell you, I have been disappointed by how things have been going in the city
for
the last couple of years. Well, let's take the whole city manager situation. Lori Lyle, I don't believe retired per se. I mean, she may have filed retirement paperwork, but I don't think she just randomly woke up one day after a year and a half in Monrovia and said, I think my career is over, especially after she just moved to town. So I think that...
Did she actually move here, buy a house and all that, was in the process?
My understanding. Or? Yeah, it's my understanding. And now she lives in Nevada. It took us over a year to find a new city manager. And Monrovia is the kind of town a city manager should be knocking down the doors to get here, where, you know, just from the magic and unique character of this community, I would think that city managers would want to come here. So that tells me that something is not quite right in the leadership and direction of the city.
So now someone running for office, did you ever make contact with Laura Lyle?
No, that's an employer-employee relationship, and I'm not going to mess with that. But I've certainly
But you're talked. Making a statement saying that you think something a little bit more happened.
Well, first off, I've spoken to people in City Hall who told me that there were other things afoot.
But that, like, would be called hearsay, wouldn't it?
Sure, absolutely. But I think that the fact of the matter is that she was only here for a year and a half. And who takes a senior executive job at the pinnacle of their career and just hangs it up after a year and a half? I don't believe the story.
Okay, but go ahead. So you talk about leadership.
Yeah.
Define leadership to you.
Well, according to the Army, leadership is the art of influencing
not
directly.
No, not the Army. I'm talking about to you as a candidate running for office.
Well, my background is in the Army, so
I understand that. But you as defining leadership.
Can I finish the sentence, Ralph?
Sure you can.
Oh, thanks. I appreciate that. Leadership is the art of influencing and directing people towards a common objective.
Okay.
All right? And that means getting them on a team. That means respecting each other's views. You don't necessarily have to agree with them, but you can respect them. I think it's about having a vision, having a goal. It's about dealing honestly with people. It's about dealing honestly with the subject matter at hand. And I see that not happening in a lot of ways in Monrovia.
All right, let's jump into vision.
Uh-huh.
What is your vision for Monrovia?
Well, I think that the vision is a lot like what we used to be, you know. Well-maintained streets, well-maintained aesthetics, a thriving economy. People constantly, as I knock on doors, point out to me potholes in their streets, backing up sewers. And I don't mean their individual home sewer. I mean, you know, every house on this block has problems with the sewer. The infrastructure in general. You know, we went to the candidates had a meeting with the city department heads recently. and the issue of water pipes came up, and the fact that we have a number of crumbling water pipes that have required intervention on an emergency basis.
But not just in this city, I think throughout the United States.
Well, that may be, that may be, but it's the responsibility of the Monrovia City Council to manage the pipes in Monrovia.
Right, right.
Excuse me. And the I asked the question, well, the 1949 was the particular time frame we were talking about, and I said, how much of our infrastructure predates 1949? And the answer I got was, we have no idea. And that tells me that there's no planning, that there is no one's keeping track of what the potentiality is. Nobody's projecting for the future. And that's just not how you run an enterprise.
So why now?
Why
are these questions being asked? What's been going on for the last 7 or 8 years?
The last 7 or 8 years? That's a very good question. You know, clearly we've had some setbacks economically.
Mm-hmm.
But that doesn't change the fact that we should be keeping track of the problem, and we should be projecting for the future, and we should be, you know, making plans for how we're going to address the issue, because we have 100-year-old pipes under our streets that aren't getting any newer.
All right. Someone might say, we don't have any money. Where are we going to get the money from?
Well, I think we have to be careful about our priorities. I think we have to look carefully at the budget. We have to look carefully at, you know, what we're doing to develop the economics of Monrovia. I mean, the list of businesses that have gone out on Myrtle Avenue is bothersome. We seem to be in an up cycle. There are a lot of storefronts being, it looks like, filled, but you know, that's the kind of thing that we should be working as a community to draw new business to.
So if you had to bring in two businesses to Monrovia, Old Town, to stabilize it, what would it be and why?
I think that we need a well-run, high-end steakhouse sort of restaurant. There's a gap for that in Monrovia. There's Mundial, but that's sort of a different demographic.
Mm-hmm.
I think we need something like that. I also think that, you know, the news is out that the Fourth Dimension is closing. I think we do need some sort of nightlife spot for the, you know, 20s crowd, ageways. If we're going to attract high-tech businesses onto Huntington Drive, we're going to have a high-tech economy, and we want those businesses to have a pool of potential employees here, then we have to provide the social network, social setting that those people would aspire to be around. Because look, this is LA traffic, right? Somebody who's coming from, you know, the west side doesn't want to commute 40 miles to have a social life if they're going to work here.
Well, let's jump to the other side of town. We have the Old Town.
Mm-hmm.
Then we got the New Town, the Gold Line area.
Yeah.
Which will be a new town in many ways, right?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
What impact will that have on Old Town?
I'm very concerned about that. I think that we have to carefully structure what's at Old Town, what's at Station Square, so that it doesn't compete with Old Town. There's been talk of a movie theater down there, and I think that's a horrible idea because I don't think Monrovia can sustain two movie theaters.
Are the movies that great?
I'm not much of a movie guy, actually,
well,
so I wouldn't know.
The movie industry has changed so much. That's why I make that.
Well, I don't pretend to be a cinema aficionado. Maybe you can talk to Lance about that.
Okay.
But I'm concerned about the economics. I'm concerned about the impacts on traffic down there. I take my son down to South Pasadena on the Gold Line, and we have a chocolate chip cookie and hot chocolate at the little diner right there,
mm-hmm,
by the train stop. And I've watched the train gates be down for as much as 12 out of 20 minutes. You do that to Myrtle and Duarte Road, and you're going to have a very serious impact on the traffic. I've walked Monroe Vista Street in recent days and talked to the people down there, and they're very concerned about the impacts on traffic on them, on the noise, you know, having a train horn every 5 minutes for the rest of their lives.
That's sort of like after the fact?
Well, you know, these are things that we're going to have to mitigate, and we're going to have to work with Metro on, and to the extent that I think that we've kind of rolled over to Metro on a lot of things, we have to stand up for ourselves. We have to stand up for the people in Monrovia.
All right. Some of the viewers out there may be wondering, what do you do for a living?
I run a company doing marketing and strategy consulting for other businesses. My clients range from a sole proprietor startup electrician here in town to a publicly traded oil company.
Okay, so when you break it down, what exactly is that?
I tell them how to tell their stories to their various audiences, whether that's customers, investors, regulators, all kinds of things.
Who's your campaign manager?
Me.
Me? Just, you're the one-man show?
That's me. Well, I got my four-year-old, but he's a little erratic
sometimes.
And they
don't vote.
No, Christopher doesn't vote.
What is the base that you're appealing to? Is there one group that you want to wake up to make them want to get up and vote?
I want everybody to vote.
But everybody's not going
to
vote.
Well, and if you're not informed on the issues, that's okay. I want everyone to be informed on the issues and participate. Look, my endorsers, you know, I live north of Foothill, and certainly I have significant ties there. But, you know, my endorsers include Gwendolyn Jones, who is a fairly well-known leader of the African-American community here in town. Jimmy Obias, who's the founder of the Latino Heritage Association. Mm-hmm. I am very deliberate about spending my time when I'm walking neighborhoods, being south of Duarte Road, south of Huntington Drive. I intend to represent all of Monrovia.
All right, how do you respond to someone out there that might say, whoa, this is one big Monrovia. Why are you worrying about the south part of town?
They pay taxes too. Mm-hmm. They deserve a voice in the community.
Do they deserve a park on that part of town?
Actually, yes, they do, and that's one of my priorities.
Okay.
Yeah.
Big park, little park?
I think the reality is that a big park would be very difficult to get down there. But
what about in the goal line area? We don't have much land for a park. It's more fix and repair station?
Well, you know, clearly the maintenance yard is a big part of that area.
Right.
I do think that there are some ways that we could go about getting a park or two south of Huntington Drive in a way that will make things more appealing to.
Was that a good deal?
What?
Fix and repair station for the goal line? Do you think we gave away too much?
We certainly gave up a lot of economic opportunity. And I think that there are a lot of unanswered questions about what was going on with that deal. I think what's done is done. We're clearly not going to put something else there. So we need to move on with the remaining opportunities there and make the best of them.
Is there anyone else on the city council supporting you?
Tom Adams is endorsing me, and okay. Alex Blackburn has endorsed me.
Okay.
Former Mayor Rob Hammond has endorsed me. The Monrovia Police Officers Association endorsed me. Dick Mountjoy, former state senator, has endorsed me. So I have support of some people who've accomplished a lot and do a lot for this community.
So that's some heavy backing.
Your words, not mine.
Okay. All right. I said it. Don't you think that's some heavy backing?
I don't disagree.
It's okay to say it. You're a candidate running for office now. play them short. That's a ride group of people,
yeah.
A diverse group of
yes.
folks running for office. Now, issue that you have taken to the forefront,
mm-hmm.
that issue, the homeless. Around Library Park.
Well, I would, you know, I use that word, and I must correct that word. That was a poor choice of words on my part.
Okay.
It
should have been what?
Well, let me address it this way. After I went down to the council and insisted three or four, maybe it was five times, that they do something about the problem in Library Park. Mm-hmm. It's a problem that I really first became aware of when. I was at the Citibank and on a Saturday afternoon, and my wife started screaming from the car, and I looked over to see a gentleman relieving himself on a tree in the park at 2:00 on a Saturday afternoon.
Broad daylight.
Yeah, it was awesome. So
did you call the police?
Yes, and when the police arrived, we watched a couple of the people in question throw their drugs away rather blatantly as the police approached, and it was this point I realized that there's a problem here. This needs to
okay.
stop. So after I insisted several times, the city established a committee to deal with the issue, and I was appointed to the committee. And we discovered some very interesting things in this committee. The homeless, per se, population problem, if you will, in Monrovia is really quite small.
Yes.
By comparison to other communities.
Mm-hmm.
The number the police department threw out was that there were 34 homeless people in Monrovia. And I thought, well, that's an awful specific number and awful conveniently low. So we looked at figures from a couple of other counts, the annual homeless count, and from the Foothill Unity Center. And lo and behold, all three of them were 34. And we came to find out that there are three groups in pretty much any city. There are three groups of homeless people. There are the recently unemployed people who are find themselves in bad circumstances, who are struggling to get out. And that's typically what you think of as a homeless person. And Monrovia's population of those is very small, because the Foothill Unity Center does an amazing, simply amazing job of taking people who are in bad positions in life, getting them the resources they need to get back on track and back where they need to.
Extending a helping hand.
Extending a helping hand. Not doing handouts. Not doing handouts, but doing hands up.
Mm-hmm.
The second of the three is your people who are mentally ill or just, you know, not capable of taking care of themselves. And these are people who are going to be sleeping in bushes, and, you know, wander the streets talking to themselves. And unfortunately, there is not a lot we can do for those people.
And what's the third type?
And the third type is what we have in Library Park. And those are people who choose to be in that circumstance. They are drug dealers. They are drunks. They have opportunities and they choose not to take them. One of the people from Library Park approached me at a council meeting after he was done speaking and lambasting our police department, which I thought was completely inappropriate. And he said he was a veteran and he just wanted to do well. And I said, well, what did you do in the military? He said, I was an aircraft mechanic. I was a sheet metal mechanic in the Air Force. I said, you know, there's a company in town called Composite Structure, or rather Decommon Aero Structures, over at Royal Oaks and Mountain. Literally right across the street from where we are right now, they make aircraft parts. I said, have you been over there and asked them for a job? He said, I didn't even know they were there. Well, this tells me he's not looking real hard.
Okay.
You know, the people in the park have been quoted in the newspaper complaining about being harassed for drinking beer in public.
Mm-hmm.
These are not people who are trying to get off the streets. These are not people who are going to the Unity Center looking for help. The city staff has talked to them individually, telling them, go to the Unity Center. They will get you the help. And they refuse to go.
So how do you respond to those that say that, okay, if this is the life that they choose to live, they have that freedom to do it?
They have that freedom to do it. They don't have a right to deal drugs in the park.
Right.
They don't have a right to harass kids in the park. They don't
arrested,
have a right to...
Right?
Yes, they should. And they should know that they are going to be watched, and that they are, that if they do something that is inappropriate to be done in a city
so
park...
So now, is Monrovia Police Department understaffed in which they can't monitor this?
The Monrovia Police Department is currently about 20% under its authorized staffing level, so I think you can say they're understaffed.
And what would you do to improve that?
I think we need to take a good, hard look at our priorities. Chief Hunt has been very upfront about saying that there is an uptick in crime coming because of realignment and prison releases and Prop 47. We've already seen an uptick in violent crime in Los Angeles, and Los Angeles tends to be a bellwether for the entire region for obvious reasons.
So now, do we have the money? There's one thing to be a candidate saying maybe we do have the money versus when you get there and then look at the books and say,
I think we need to be creative. We have to make careful decisions about our priorities, but we also need to look at things like reserve officers, like retired officers coming back, things along these lines that we can leverage to bring more resources to the fight. You know, I think that reserve officers are an excellent solution in a number of ways. They cost less, but also, you know, if you bring reserve officers from the community, you have a better tie with the community because you have people who are on both sides of the experience.
All right. Now, how have you been campaigning as far as signs and getting the word out that I'm no longer a write-in candidate, but guess what? My name's on the ballot this time.
Well, I, you know, certainly my name is on the ballot, so that right there says my name is on the ballot.
There's progress there. But you got to get to the poll to realize that.
Sure, and, you know, I've been doing exactly what I did the last time, which is walking neighborhoods and knocking on doors and talking to voters.
Do you put up signs? Do you advertise in the newspaper?
I have my signs out. I am working on a budget. If anyone would like to contribute, it's parryformonrovia.com, P-A-R-R-Y for Monrovia.com. Take donations there. We're doing some social media, doing some web advertising. And like I said, knocking on doors and rubbing out the shoe leather.
The most challenging question someone has asked you when you knocked on the door?
Oh, wow. Most challenging question somebody has asked me when I knocked on a door? Well, I did have one guy ask who I voted for president, and when I expressed my sentiment, he slammed the door in my face, so that was sort of emotionally challenging, I guess you might say.
Okay, that's a little accurate. How often have you received a slam door?
Not many. Monrovia is a pretty cordial community. You know, I think most people respect anyone who's willing to get out there and try and serve the community.
What do you say to people who say, well, your politics seems a little bit to the far right?
Well, my politics is not to the far right. I'm much more of a libertarian. I think the government doesn't belong in most decisions in life. My answer to pretty much anyone who disagrees with me on pretty much anything in life is, why don't we have a beer and go talk about it? Because I think that...
You get them drunk and you can convince them?
No, I think that a good conversation tends to make for good friends, you know.
Well, I think the president tried that once and it didn't really work out well.
Well, you know...
Remember the beer conference?
I do remember the beer conference I believe in authentic conversation.
Okay.
Ralph, clearly you and I have some political differences, but every time we sit down and chat, we tend to have a pretty good time.
Yeah.
I think that if you're respectful of others and you're respectful of their experience and differences in people, that we can all get along pretty well. Not knowing the unknown creates a lot of mystery and a lot of tension.
And distrust, too.
And distrust, absolutely.
Welcome to KGEM. Candidates running for political office. On February 13th, while one of the candidates were in the studio, a funny thing happened. We lost time. But we're going to make up that time. And I'm glad to have back in the studio Mr. Robert Parry. How you doing today, sir?
Good to see you again, Ralph. How are you?
All right. So let me just start off with a question. At the last time you ran for political office, you mm-hmm. pulled in some amazing numbers mm-hmm. as a write-in candidate.
Write-in candidate, yes, sir.
And tell me, how do you think you're going to duplicate that magic in a sense to get those numbers? I believe it was, what was the number?
It was 1,084 votes I got out of about 3,000 ballots, so clearly.
Pretty much at the last minute.
Pretty much at the last minute, yeah. I mean, the campaign only went about 5 weeks versus 3 months, so. I think that, my signs look the same and whatnot, so I've got some name recognition there. I've tapped into the supporters that I knew I had last time and, you know, been sending a mail and things like that. So, I'm not taking anything for granted, though. I don't expect anyone who wrote my name on the ballot last time to vote for me. There are some good... good-hearted people that are running hard themselves, and I know I've lost some supporters to some of those folks. I've also picked up supporters in other corners. So
what is the different dynamic this time?
The last time we had two candidates running for two seats on the ballot, plus me, trying to draw some attention. This time we have eight candidates running for two seats. And it's a vastly different race. Plus, we have the mayor's race, which last time wasn't mm-hmm. contended.
So that should bring more voters to the polls, right?
I think that we'll see a better turnout, yes.
So what issue do you think really stands out versus from the last time?
I think that Monrovia, let me speak to myself. Mm-hmm. I think Monrovia is a very special community, and I think we have to be very diligent about protecting it. Monrovia is special not just because of our architecture, which is special and unique, and it creates a unique ambiance for the town. And we're not special just because of Old Town. And we're not special just because we have this emerging high-tech corridor down on Huntington Drive. But I think that you take the mix of what Monrovia has, and it's really remarkable. You can go from that high-tech corridor mm-hmm. up to a waterfall in a real wilderness area in about 15 minutes, and there's nowhere in Southern California that you can do that. But perhaps most importantly, you look at Old Town, and you look at what is, demographically, sociologically, whatever you want to call it, 5 minutes north and 5 minutes south, and you have some very different set of life experiences. But, you know, on a Friday night in Old Town, you go to Bellacera or Mundial or Cafe Opera or Rudy's, and you'll find people from north and south sitting at tables next to each other, and a lot of times you'll find them sitting at the same table. Now, I think that is a level of interaction that is really unprecedented in most of the world, and I think that that makes Monrovia a truly special place.
So do you think Monrovia is void of race problems?
Well, Ralph, I think that Monrovia's history in that regard is pretty well documented. You know, I have a friend of mine from the VFW, Norman Ross, who was born in Monrovia about 90 years ago, served in World War II, and he's told me some pretty mind-boggling stories about the way things used to be. You know, clearly there are some people who hold, you know, outdated views. Mm-hmm. And there are also some people who, you know, are adapting to the new way of looking at the world, on both sides of the issue, frankly.
Is it really a new way of looking at the world?
Or
is
I don't think it's deniable that over the last, you know, 40, 50 years, people have, you know, values have changed, people's way of looking at things have changed. So I think that it's an important development in Monrovia, and it's an important conversation to have. But, you know, it's, I don't think it's a, I think that it is something that makes this place special and allows for some kind of unique experiences.
So it is a conversation that's still evolving. I guess you could say that in many ways.
Well, in our little corner of the universe and nationwide, I don't think that's debatable, especially what we've seen over the last, you know, 5 or 6 months.
Okay, let's bring it back to Old Town Monrovia.
Yes, sir.
And Monroe Days.
Uh-huh.
Have sort of like disappeared, the great parade, and
yep,
and that brought everyone back down together.
Yep.
Celebrating,
yep,
the colorful history of Monrovia.
Yep.
Sort of disappeared. It did disappear.
Yeah, it's been replaced by a music festival. And I've heard a lot of voices in town that would like to see us bring back, you know, I think they would like to get there's a consensus in town, I think, that we would like to get back to the days of the festival in the park and the parade. You know, there used to be the Soapbox Derby and things like that. I'm not sure if that's really an achievable goal the way society seems to be these days, but you know, if we can, fantastic. But I think the parade is definitely something that needs to come back. That was a culturally unique thing about Monrovia and a real touchstone for the whole town. I think we should strive to get that back.
So if you had to pick out something to bring back, it would be the parade?
I think the parade, just logistically, is probably the easier part to execute. And I think that it was the hallmark, and, you know, everybody knew to come out for the parade. So I would like to see certainly the parade come back in the next couple of years, absolutely.
Oh, okay. Let's talk about one of the new business that's going to be in the Gold Line area,
mm-hmm.
Wine and Cheese.
Wine of the Month Club, yes.
Yes. What's your take on that? Do you think that's a good fit for that part of town? Is everybody in Monrovia into wine and cheese?
Well, you know, we had California Wine and Cheese, and that didn't do so well. I think that there were perhaps some business challenges that were unique to that location that could work themselves out in time. The success or failure of the Wine of the Month Club location is going to really depend on what else is there. If it's a standalone, I don't know, it's going to be tough for them to draw that. But if there are, you know, 12 or 15 other businesses around that are, you know, drawing more customers, and people go in there and make their impulse purchases, mm-hmm. Plan a trip down there for two or three things, not just that, you know, access off the Gold Line because there's, you know, that sort of a series of businesses there, then that may work. But it's, it's got to be a package deal. So that's going to be a long-term focus for the community. And largely, you know, with redevelopment somewhat out of the picture now, well, largely out of the picture, our ability to influence what goes on that real estate is also going to be limited.
Now, part of your campaign, you've talked about your experience as a military guy.
Yes, sir.
Someone asked me the question, were you actually involved in combat?
Oh, yes. I have fired my weapon to protect my life and that of others. I have called artillery strikes. I've had 3 IEDs go off on my vehicles in Baghdad. I've buried a lot of friends. Yes, I have, as we say in the military, I have seen the elephant.
Okay, the most important thing have you learned from being engaged in war?
That war is a really bad thing, and it's a lot better if we can get along with each other and find a way to get past each other's differences. Hate and violence are abhorrent, and we should avoid them at all costs, but if someone brings them upon us, then we have to do what we have to do to protect ourselves.
All right, and if you had one thing to say to the voters out there after the elections are done, and let's say you win, what would it be?
On April 15th, we're still all Monrovians. I don't care who you vote for. I don't care what your goals are. If you forget that we are all Monrovians on April 15th, you are missing the point of the election.
All right, sounds good to me. Don't forget that date, April 14th. Get out and vote. All right, they're telling me the hands of time is moving fast, so this is your opportunity to look right in that camera there and tell the viewers out there why they should vote for you and why they should bring somebody to come along and vote too, to break up that voter apathy.
Well, you should vote for me because I am the leader with leadership experience in the military and in the business world who will move Monrovia forward and make decisions based on the information presented, not on a hidden agenda. I would encourage you to vote because it's the right thing to do for your community. I encourage you to vote after you've researched the issues and researched the candidates and know what's at hand and bring someone along because that is the best thing for democracy. And I went overseas 3 times for democracy. I'd like you to value the gift that myself and my fellow soldiers gave you.
All right. Appreciate that so
Ralph,
much.
Ralph, always a pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
And don't forget, get out there and vote. Not by the party, but for the person.